Hello and welcome to Showcase. Today, romance, harps, and the Met. If you haven't had enough love stories at the movies, Netflix has a royal offering. Using the world as his musical canvas, we'll take you on a sonic journey with a colossal earth harp. And when you can't go to a museum, let the museum come to you. The paperback romance novel with its steamy couple on the cover is making a comeback on Netflix. Nursen Atutar has more on the streaming services, Bridgerton.
All is fair in love and war.
Jane Austen meets Gossip Girl and 45 Shades of Grey.
Daphne Bridgerton!
That's how the cast explains Netflix's new Regency historical romance series.
For the social season.
Tighter! Bridgerton is an 8-part series based on the books by Julia Quinn.
You do not know me, but I...
It's set in London's high society, during a not-so-historically accurate 19th century. The first season focuses on the eldest daughter, Daphne, as she tries to score an eligible husband. The creator of the show, Chris Van Dusen, hopes to make 7 more seasons. One for each of the Bridgerton brothers and sisters.
I'm here on friends.
This is my sister.
Duke. Although this subgenre of historical romance novels made publishers a lot of money, the Regency romance genre has been mostly overlooked on the screen.
I'd like to think you're happy about that.
Julia Quinn told to The Guardian that they're the ugly stepchild of the publishing industry, and that whenever a period drama is made, it's usually another Jane Austen. Though Netflix's Bridgerton seems to have bucked that trend. Lady Whistledown has all... Netflix tweeted that in its first 4 weeks, the show has been courted by 63 million households. They'll have a lot more storytelling to watch. For the upcoming seasons, the program is rumored to be delving deeper into the topics such as race and sexual orientation. Not your typical tale of merry old England.
You must appear madly in love.
The Duke truly has put your head in a spin. Is it awful that I'm enjoying it?
Let's talk to Sarah Fickey, who's a bit of an expert on this topic. She is an English professor, and her current research at Marymount University focuses on popular historical romance fiction. Hi there, thanks for being with us today. So, I would say that there is quite a lot of interest in romance novels when it comes to TV, but then Regency romance, the subgenre, is really kind of overlooked, isn't it? Why is that?
Well, there are a few reasons. I think one is that romance fiction in general is overlooked, I think primarily because it's a genre that's directed at women, and it's traditionally been published in a very popular format. It's often sold at grocery stores, it's sold at big stores, it's not considered part of the literary group of text. And so it doesn't get the same kind of recognition that other genres do. Even other popular genres like mysteries still get more credibility than romance. The romance genre has gotten up till this point.
And then when it comes to Regency romance, the situation is even a lot worse then, isn't it?
It is. I think Regency romance is one of the most popular genres of romance fiction. So if you go to a romance-focused bookstore, or if you look online, there are many Regency romances out there. And there have been. They've been published since the early 20th century. But because they are romance novels and because they're historical, especially when you're thinking about putting a romance on film, there are certain barriers. There's, you know, the cost of doing a historical drama, and there's the interest in sort of representing the period. I think with Bridgerton, people are starting to realize that there's a real market for Regency romance on screen.
In an interview with Guardian, writer of Bridgerton, the novel series, Julia Quinn, she said that people look down on romance novels and especially the Regency genre, subgenre, because they are the ugly stepchild of the publishing industry. I wonder where this kind of stance comes from, so that we can talk about Bridgerton and what it is doing differently.
Well, Regency romance, I think, is particularly targeted for being something that's very formulaic. People see it as a series of books that are very much the same. They're about a duke. They're about a beautiful young woman who is coming out in society and going to balls and trying to find a husband. And so people assume that the books are all essentially the same and that there's not a lot of depth to them. There's not a lot of differentiation. When in fact, there is quite a lot of depth, and there's been a lot of change over time. So even though some of the characters and scenarios in Julia Quinn's books are the same as the ones from the Regencies that were published in the 1930s, the 1940s, the stories themselves are actually very different. The way the characters react and feel are very different. Regency romance has really changed with the times. But I think the public perception of romance does not always catch up with that. So there's a public perception that romance is formulaic, that it's all the same, and that it's not something that contemporary people, particularly the wider viewership, are going to relate to. Again, that also has to do with the fact that romance has primarily traditionally been read by women, and though women are a very powerful media market, they're not always seen that way.
Interesting. Okay, the Netflix series Bridgerton sort of updates this genre with more modern race and gender attitudes and representations. Do you think this is a successful move?
I think it's a move in the right direction, and it's been successful in a certain number of ways. I think it's really important to have multiracial casting on television, and to be able to take a genre which has been traditionally very, very white and make it more racially diverse, especially because during the actual Regency period, London was a racially diverse city. That was not apparent in Regency romance for a very long time because it was being written by white women who weren't invested in representing that. So I think it's great that Bridgerton has done that. However, as many critics have noticed, especially Black critics, there are some issues with the way that the race has been represented on screen, particularly in the characters who are getting focused on as people who are the objects of the happy ending and ones who are not. So for example, none of the Black female characters yet has been set up for a happy ending. So while it's making some great progress to have this diversity represented on screen, and while the gender roles have been updated in a really interesting way, there's still some issues. There's also some issues with sexual consent in this first season that appear in the book, but I think many people were hoping would have been updated a little bit more differently. For now, the book is 20 years old. And, you know, the way that we think about things now is not exactly the same the way that we thought about things in 2000.
And do you think the genre needed this sort of an update?
I think that if you read the books, there are a lot of books being written now in this genre that are updated, that have a more contemporary sensibility, though they're set in the Regency period. But this particular book series, like I said, the you know, started coming out 20 years ago, I think it was smart for them to update it. I think it was important. You know, hopefully this is a really good basis for future adaptations, maybe of series that are more recent series or series by more diverse creators that would require a different kind of updating and maybe not so much updating in certain areas.
Mm-hmm. And do you think it would be relevant and watchable and this successful if there were no such updates?
I think that, you know, it would still be a beautiful story and it would still be a beautiful setting. But I think it's much more interesting and much more relatable to people now to have a story that is trying to think about diversity and inclusivity and the way that characters are represented and the way that men and women relate to each other. You know, the making that connect with the modern viewing audience, I think you have to keep them in mind. And so while I think any romance readers would have been happy to see Bridgerton adapted to screen. The way that they're doing this now and trying to update it, I think, is the right move.
Mm-hmm. And it is interesting that Netflix adaptation chose a series that is kind of older. Now that you told me that the genre, you know, is being updated, you know, and people are writing new books in this genre.
Yes, I think they picked it because it has an established fan base. I mean, it's a long genre, or it's a long series, so there's a lot of books that they could use. And it's also very popular. I mean, you have people who are a built-in viewing audience, and some of the newer authors might not have that same name recognition. So hopefully Julia Quinn's books are paving the way for more adaptations, potentially by people who are newer authors who maybe don't have the same name recognition from having published for so long and built up this enormous fan base, but who are writing books that are set in the same time period, or just writing historical books that have these sweeping, dramatic love stories full of interesting characters. You know, there are other authors in Britain and in America who are doing this work. And I hopefully this is a gateway that's sort of proving that there is an audience for these things. And from now on, they can say, if you liked Bridgerton, you should watch this new series.
All right, Sarah Fickey, let's hope that to be the case. It's lovely to have you on Showcase today. Thanks. William Close has invented a harp that can be played across a canyon or a forest. The musician slash artist slash engineer has taken the idea of performance art to a new level and literally onto a whole new stage. Bart van Diever caught up with him in Hollywood just before the pandemic hit.
I come from an architecture, music, and sculpture background, but I grew up on sailboats, and the result is that I'm really an instrument inventor, instrument designer, and performer and composer. The Earth Harp is an instrument I invented in late 2000, and basically the first time I set it up, and the reason it's titled Earth Harp is I mounted a series of chambers to one side of a valley or a canyon and ran strings all the way over to the other side. So it turned the canyon into a giant harp, the world's first Earth Harp. Since then, I've actually taken it all around the world to some interesting places. It adapts to the environment it's in. So, you know, I've strung it to the top of mountain peaks before. I've strung it across fields and old growth forests. I've strung it to lots of different concert halls. In a concert hall, it just mounts to the stage, and the strings go out and attach to the balcony. And so it works really well in concert halls, and the audience is actually inside the instrument. Recently, I was in Singapore, and there was a skyscraper that I strung the Earth Harp to there, and Guinness was there and the World Record Association, and they gave me the world record. So it's a world record harp. I come from a rigging background, being a sailor. That stuff, I have a good time figuring that stuff out, you know. I basically lowered each string off the top of the building, and the first string took about 2 hours to run. And when we were done, we were running strings about every 15 minutes. So it was a pretty complex one. So it's played with gloves with violin rosin, and you run your hands along the strings. So it's actually it's a very bow sounding instrument. So that sounds like it's being bowed. And so I compare it to, you know, cellos or an interesting string section in an orchestra, or it's definitely got that lush symphonic sound. And I think it really, really affects people, and people love it. You know, I'm always developing new instruments and new directions and trying to refine what I'm already doing, you know. So, I've invented over 100 instruments, and so there's lots that are always in development as well. I just turned my son's trampoline into an instrument, mic'd it up, and it sounds great as he bounces on it. Some of the places I've taken the Earth Harp have been the Grand Theater in Shanghai, or the Colosseum in Rome. I recently did a residency at the Kennedy Center in Washington, D.C., and lots of interesting places. Each installation is a story in itself. A lot of people love it, you know. It pushes the imagination and sounds great. You know, I'm inspired by Frank Lloyd Wright, the architect. He used to say that architecture is frozen music. And I always thought it was a cool idea. And the idea of seeing architecture as music and then actually turning it into a way to create music is interesting to me. And so with the Earth Harp, that's what I do. I sort of unfreeze the music.
While the pandemic has stopped Close from playing live in front of audiences, it hasn't stopped him from harnessing his creative powers. He spends his days tinkering with metal, string, and other objects, weaving together new instruments, and as a result, new sounds. He also runs live streamed performances from his home and plans to keep his music alive across social media channels until the pandemic is lifted. And once it has, William Close will no doubt have new sounds and new instruments to perform, where people can once again be a part of the show.
Bart Vandiver, TRT World, Los Angeles.
The coronavirus crisis has forced many museums and art galleries to close their doors. But one New York tech company has found a way for people to personally explore the masterpieces in the city's largest art museum.
Really excited to announce an incredible immersive art experience.
The creators of the Met Unframed are calling the project a masterpiece of digital inclusivity. The 50 works in the Metropolitan Museum of Art's collection from never-before-seen galleries are available on mobile devices so people everywhere can experience art, even if they're on another continent. In collaboration with U.S. telecommunications firm Verizon, the Met Unframed is a demonstration of the potential of next-generation 5G connectivity in an online environment. The immersive virtual art and gaming experience with enhancements is entirely powered by Verizon's 5G Ultra Wideband.
Thanks to AR, made possible by one of the currencies of 5G, extremely high bandwidth, students and educators from across the country can explore objects like the Apollo 11 command module you see here.
Vestig also says that the global pandemic has fast-tracked innovations in the online sphere.
This mass shift sped up the timeline for work from home, distant learning, and telemedicine. We knew it was coming, but it was closer than we realized. Now, instead of being our future, it's our present. High-fidelity 3D scans of objects.
So while 5G networks promise higher speeds and greater connectivity, they also hold the promise of keeping us connected to an expansive global platform for the arts in a time of crisis.
Audrey Hepburn was a Hollywood icon, but she was also an extremely private person. Now, her admirers are getting a chance to see a more private part of the actor and how she went from poverty to Tinseltown royalty.
The best kept secret about Audrey was that she wanted to be loved.
Audrey, the documentary, aims to go beyond Audrey Hepburn's star image to unveil her mystique. It delves into the Belgian-born British actress's personal life, including her years during World War II and her work as a UN ambassador. It took director Helena Cohn more than 2 years to craft the film. The feature has a good number of guests, including Hepburn's son, Sean Hepburn Ferrer, and her director on the relationship comedy, They All Laughed, Peter Bogdanovich. Reviewers have noted there are many heartfelt moments in the documentary, similar to those in her films that are sure to please fans. Yet, Audrey seems to have fallen flat with some critics. The Guardian says the film, quote, blandly celebrates her iconic presence in Breakfast at Tiffany's, yet ignores her other auteur-directed films, such as Two for the Road and Robin and Marion. That review also takes issue with the documentary's exclusion of her refusal to work with Alfred Hitchcock. Yet, the Guardian piece does say that the personal bits in the film are candidly approached. Like Hepburn's parents', quote, political infatuations with Nazism before the war. To conclude, London Evening Standard also chimed in, arguing that Audrey feels like it was designed to soothe hardcore fans. And it could be true, as they have been waiting for a documentary, any documentary of any sort, for a long time.
When I love unconditionally.
In the Netherlands, a field comes to life with a display of LED light beaming across a crop of leeks. It's a visual feast and good for the crops too.
Have you ever seen crops in Technicolor? Long after the sun has set on this field of leeks on a quiet farm in the Dutch town of Lelystad, that's exactly what happens. LED lights in red, blue and ultraviolet project across the plant's leaves in a mesmerising nighttime display. It's part art installation and part science. The project is called Grow and it pairs the plant's natural beauty with a futuristic light show. It's the brainchild of artist Dan Rosegaard, who wanted to pay homage to farmers and inspire them to experiment with artificial light in outdoor farming.
The mission was to do something from a creative perspective, from a design and innovation perspective. On one hand, showing the beauty of sustainability, of sustainable agriculture. And on the other hand, sort of, that's my personal interest, sort of highlighting science or light science to speed up potential development to improve the world. So it's a combination of sectors.
Using specialized LEDs to assist crops grown in greenhouses has become common. And vertical farms in cities grown entirely with LEDs are becoming increasingly popular. Rosegaard says LEDs have potential outdoors in rural areas for the same reason.
Somewhere, somehow, the notion of light recipes, the word light recipes popped up. And so what's a light recipe? That's a specific wavelength designed to activate something, right? We as humans are very sensitive to light, sun or different colors, but so are plants. And so we found out the red and the blue light help plants to grow better. And this has been around for many years, but indoor, nobody has ever done it outdoor. And the notion of ultraviolet light, which can sort of boost the resistance of the plant and therefore reduce the use of pesticides.
A film of the exhibit will be launched on Studio Rosegaard's website from Monday. Rosegaard's goal is to take Grow to 40 different countries, with each installation featuring a local or national crop with its own unique light recipe.
We've seen on this program how it's possible to find art in the wake of a natural disaster. And now Turkey's largest humanitarian organization explores this concept during the past 150 years.
The entire visual history of a humanitarian organization. Former aid campaigns, photographs, books, stamps, engravings, announcement posters about blood donation and first aid. And thanks to the determined collectors, some of them date back to the very first years of the institution. Our endless solidarity story, The Red Crescent, was opened to celebrate the 153rd anniversary of the organization and underlined the feeling of unity that has been going on for years.
As the Red Crescent, we have a responsibility to give the food needed by the human body and deliver it to the people who need it. On the other hand, it is also necessary to satisfy the hunger of the human being for art and culture, because the human body is a healthy whole together with the soul.
The curator says the exhibit offers a chance for visitors to witness the history of Turkey, not just the Red Crescent, with graphics, drawings, and objects of the period.
They will be able to watch a magnificent Kızılay movie, which consists of a single episode that tells the 150-year-old story of the Red Crescent. It will be a dynamic exhibition and it will change. This is our own journey and our own story.
And the organizers hope to turn this more than 150-year journey into a museum. Until then, they are asking people to visit the exhibition at the Tarık Zafer Tunaya Cultural Center on Istanbul's bustling İstiklal Street.
That's it on this episode of Showcase. Our YouTube channel, Instagram, and Twitter account have more from the world of arts and culture. I'm Elif Bereketli. Thanks for watching. Bye for now.